Good morning. Welcome to Cornwall Presbyterian Church. We're so glad to have you with us here today. If you're visiting with us this morning, we're delighted to welcome you. I do have some announcements to share with you today. First, our sensibility collection, that is all the spare change you may have been collecting in your households, is today from 11:30 to 12:30. We are doing a drive-by collection on Church Street, and the money that we collect will be used to support hunger ministries in our area. We are also collecting food for loaves and fishes, and that can be we will be collecting that through Tuesday, November 17th. We have also the 53rd Annual Ecumenical Thanksgiving Service coming up on Tuesday, November 24th. That is the Tuesday before Thanksgiving at 7:30 p.m. We are the hosts of this year's Thanksgiving service. Because of the pandemic circumstance, we are pre-recording this service, including all of the representatives from our faith communities. And we will be showing this recording at a Zoom at 7:30 on Tuesday, the 24th. We are also going to be posting this service on YouTube and on our website. We look forward to gathering together in this way. We remain in the midst of our stewardship campaign. If you have not already done so, I encourage you to prayerfully consider what commitment you might be able to make to our ministry in the coming year. Pledges can be made through our website at cornwallpresbyterian.org, or pledge cards can be mailed to the church, and we look forward to sharing this ministry together. Our stewardship theme is our journey through the wilderness. We continue this journey today in our worship service as we consider the very well-known story of God's provision of manna on the ground. Let us turn now to our call to worship. God is in the water that restores our soul. God is in the night when we lose our way. God is in today and tomorrow, raising up leaders, prophets, and dreamers. And God is in the wilderness with us every step of the way. So with confidence we declare, if God is in those spaces, when God is surely here, let us worship the God of creation. Let us worship the God of wilderness spaces. As we light the Christ candle, let us remember the presence of God in our wilderness journey. As we journey through the wilderness, we are aware that this is a time for confession, for acknowledging our humanity and trusting in God's love and forgiveness. Let us pray. Forgive us, God, for our grumbling and complaining. We so often forget all you have done for us. We forget how you have heard our cries when we suffer. We take our food and shelter for granted. We get stuck in the moment with our pressing concerns and forget the future you're calling us toward. Help us to faithfully journey toward your purpose and ministry. Amen. The good news is that even if at first we do not hear the divine word addressed to us, God calls us again and again. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
Good morning. Let us pray. Dear Lord and Father, thank you that you promise us that where two or three are gathered, you are there in the midst. Lord, we welcome you among us today and celebrate the gift of life that you have lavished upon each of us. We ask that you would open our ears so that we may hear your voice. Open our minds so that we may receive your eternal wisdom. Open our spirits so that you may know your leading and guidance. And open our hearts so that we may receive your wonderful love. We ask all this in the glorious name of Jesus. Amen. Today I'm going to be reading from the King James translation of the Bible. And our Old Testament reading this morning is from the book of Exodus, chapter 16, verses 2 through 15. Hear the word of the Lord. And the whole congregation of the children of Israel murmured against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. And the children of Israel said unto them, Would to God we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt, when we sat by the flesh pots, and when we did eat bread to the full. For ye have brought us forth into this wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger. Then said the Lord unto Moses, Behold, I will rain bread from heaven for you, and the people shall go out and gather a certain rate every day, that I may prove them whether they will walk in my law or no. And it shall come to pass that on the sixth day they shall prepare that which they bring in, and it shall be twice as much as they gather daily. And Moses and Aaron said unto all the children of Israel, At even, then ye shall know that the Lord hath brought you out from the land of Egypt. And in the morning, then ye shall see the glory of the Lord, for that he heareth your murmurings against the Lord. And what are we that ye murmur against us? And Moses said, This shall be, when the Lord shall give you in the evening flesh to eat, and in the morning bread to the full, for that the Lord heareth your murmurings which ye murmur against him. And what are we? Your murmurings are not against us, but against the Lord. And Moses spake unto Aaron, and said unto all the congregations of the children of Israel, Come near before the Lord, for he hath heard your murmurings. And it came to pass, as Aaron spake unto the whole congregation of the children of Israel, that they looked toward the wilderness, and behold, the glory of the Lord appeared in the cloud. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, I have heard the murmurings of the children of Israel. Speak unto them, saying, At even ye shall eat flesh, and in the morning ye shall be filled with bread, and ye shall know that I am the Lord your God. And it came to pass that at even the quails came up and covered the camp, and in the morning the dew lay round about the host. And when the dew that lay was gone up, behold, upon the face of the wilderness there lay a small round thing, as small as the hoar frost on the ground. And when the children of Israel saw it, they said one to the other, It is manna. For they wist not what it was. And Moses said unto them, This is the bread which the Lord hath given you to eat. And our New Testament lesson this morning is from the first letter of Paul to the people at Corinth, chapter 10, verses 1 through 4. Hear the word of the Lord. Moreover, brethren, I would not that ye should be ignorant how that all fathers were under the cloud, and all passed through the sea, and were all baptized unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea, and did all eat the same spiritual meat, and did all drink the same spiritual drink, for they drank of that spiritual rock that followed them, and that rock was Christ. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And now I'm switching. Excuse me. And now this is our stewardship for minute. Stewardship minute. Minute for stewardship. When I first heard that the theme of our stewardship campaign this year was thinking of the wilderness as a place of new growth and the beginning of something wonderful, rather than as a place of desolation, I thought of a women's retreat we had several years ago, at which our leader, Harriet Sandmeyer, used the desert as the example of a place that seems to be empty and desolate, but actually is a place of beauty and is populated by all of God's creations, if we but look for them. And then I started thinking about these past 8 months that seem as though they have contained nothing but sorrow and deprivation and upheaval in our lives. And I wondered if the pandemic will or has actually started to make us more aware of God's constant presence in our lives. When I started thinking about our wonderful church and all of the people and groups that have always helped others and made us aware of God's helping hand and love, I decided to tell you a true story about our wonderful prayer chain and how it helped me through a terrible time. I will call this a moment for prayership. 9 years ago, my younger brother Paul had been complaining about not feeling well and thought he had the flu. And finally, he told me that on Friday he was going to see the doctor after work. He called late that afternoon to let me know that he was at the hospital because his family doctor thought his stomach problems might be the result of diverticulitis, and he wanted Paul to get an x-ray to make sure. A few hours later, Paul called again in relatively high spirits because the x-rays had shown that it was his appendix that had been causing him so much discomfort and that the doctor was going to remove it. Paul has heart problems and has been on blood thinners forever, so they couldn't operate until his blood levels came down. So the surgeon spent the night in the hospital waiting for the moment he could operate. While all of this was going on with Paul, his wife Kay was in a real quandary because she planned to go home to Illinois that weekend to be with her mother, who was in poor health. Paul assured her that an appendectomy was a relatively easy surgery and told her to leave first thing on Saturday morning for the six-hour drive to her hometown. On Saturday morning, we heard from one of our nieces that Paul was in surgery and Kay was on her way to Mendota, and all was well with their family. I was worried as always, though, because that's what I do in crises, when it seemed like it was taking the surgeon a very long time to finish the surgery. And I can remember standing in ShopRite, where Grant and I had gone to while away the time, and calling Diane Haas and asking her, because she knows everything about everything medical, if the operation seemed to be taking an unusually long time. And she said she knew that things were going to go well and wondered when Paul might actually have gotten into the operating room, whether things were going on, so I felt somewhat relieved. Later, after we got home, our older niece Jennifer called with awful news. The surgeon found that it was Paul's appendix that was at fault, but that it had burst, and Paul was not expected to survive. The hospital had called in an infectious disease specialist who told Jennifer and her sister Sarah that should Paul survive the surgery, his recovery was going to take a very long time, and it would take weeks, if not months, for him to return to work. He was on a ventilator. Both girls were terrified about what was going on, and their poor mother was halfway to Illinois and didn't know which way to turn, literally. I put down the phone and felt like someone had kicked me in the stomach. I can remember sitting in our living room and clutching Grant's hand so tightly that I was afraid I was hurting him. I was trying to think of what I could do, and I immediately thought I should call Dot Lawrence, who was the head of our church prayer chain. I asked Grant to make the call because I was too upset, and he called and filled her in on Paul's progress, and she passed the information along to the rest of the prayer chain. I swear that it was less than an hour later that the phone rang again, and it was our younger niece calling to tell us that Paul was off the ventilator, was sitting up, and was complaining about being hungry. I don't know if any one of us ever used the word miracle out loud, but I know that God healed my beloved brother Paul on that day, and his instrument was our prayer chain. Paul was released from the hospital on Monday and went back to work on Thursday. And from that day forward, I've always realized the power not only of prayer, but especially of CPC prayers. No pandemic or election or civil unrest can ever change God's loving care for all of us. And we can find hope even in the wilderness, as I did. I learned many lessons that day and in the past year and a half during which Grant has been so sick. First, I learned that God answers prayers. I learned that the people in our church support and email and make us laugh and hug virtually or in person and make us laugh and send cards and bring food and make us laugh no matter what. And I learned that only God knows what is going to happen, and we should never question or worry about what the future may hold.
I invite any children who may be in our households this morning to come to gather for children's time. Today, our scripture text tells us a story of how God provided manna for the Israelites in the wilderness. When we see them today, they are grumbling and complaining. They've forgotten that God delivered them from slavery in Egypt. They forgot how God parted the Red Sea. They forgot that God provided water from a rock, and all they can think about is how hungry they are, and they are complaining and they are unhappy. And then God gives them food on the ground, manna, every morning for them to eat. He gives them exactly as much as they need. And they ask Moses, what is it? And in fact, manna, that's what it means. What is it? And Moses says that this is the bread that the Lord has given you to eat. Well, I was thinking, we talked about gratitude journals a few weeks ago, but recently I saw at a friend's house a big wall that had a rolled out piece of paper on it in their entryway, and it said wall of gratitude, and they put questions on it, and everybody in their family as they walked by would just answer these questions every day. Now the big wall of gratitude was a bit much for me to pull off, so I put a little piece of paper on one of the kitchen cabinets, so every time we get a drink of water we can write down what we're grateful for. But I thought it was a great practice, and parents, I thought, might work well for our children and maybe for all of us in our households as a way to remember the bread that God has given us to eat. And so I started one here, and those who are involved in putting this service together already contributed to it. I called it a wall of gratitude, and you could make it on a big wall or on a cabinet or wherever you walk by a lot. And we put little questions on it to make us think. So one is, how has God surprised you today? And somebody has answered with beautiful sunshine, seeing Brendan outside, wisdom on social media, oh, and humorous animal antics. And I would say for myself, I will add silly cats. And if you want, you could draw a picture of a cat if you don't want to write down the words. And then another question we asked, what is the bread we have found? So what is it that God is giving us to help us live our lives? And somebody wrote recipe ingredients already at hand. So that means they needed to make something and they found they already had everything they needed. Kindness, golf, and grocery stores. I wonder who wrote that one. I would say when my daughter made me dinner, that was pretty nice. So we have lots of things to be thankful for, and there are lots of questions that we might pose on different pieces of paper here, but practices of gratitude help us remember all that God has given us and what it is that sustains us each day. Let's pray. God, we are so grateful for the bread that you provide us each day. We are grateful for all you give us that sustains us and surprises us with joy. We ask that you will help us to see all that we have as a gift. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. saving your life right now? This is a question Barbara Brown Taylor asks. I've also heard this question reframed as, what is sustaining your life right now? I'm not sure how the Israelites would have answered this question when we meet them in the wilderness today. If we were there with them, we might easily help them answer. God heard our cries, saw our suffering, and God saved us, delivering us from slavery. God parted the Red Sea for us to cross. We got thirsty in the wilderness, and God provided water from a rock. Now we're on our way to the Promised Land. This is their recent history, and yet it is not fresh on their minds. They are complaining and grumbling against Moses and Aaron, even charging them with intent to kill them all with hunger. They indulge in fictitious fantasies of past glory, remembering flesh pots and full bellies in Egypt, forgetting the back-breaking labor of slavery. On other occasions, when we have investigated this text together, I have been harsh with the Israelites and their complaining behavior. How is it that they have so quickly forgotten what God has done for them? However, today, we might feel more sympathy for the Israelites than we once did. After all, we likely feel we are living in our own wilderness. We also are navigating terrain that we do not know. We are frustrated by inconveniences. Perhaps we are angry that our lives have had to change. We are uncertain how to plan for the future, and we may also doubt that there is a promised land ahead of us. And as the number of COVID infections rise in our area, we are fearful of getting sick. An increasing number of us have discovered the uncomfortable worry for loved ones who are sick with the virus. And even as we struggle with the pandemic, of course, life marches on. Health concerns, finances, and political strife press in around us. We identify with the Israelites much more than we once did. Even the incident of hoarding manna and having it go bad may feel a little closer to home. So we may take greater comfort as we discover that despite their difficult behavior, God hears the Israelites' complaints. It seems without even a delay, God provides them with food in the form of manna on the ground. Manna that arrives every morning, enough for every person to have exactly what they need. On the sixth day, God provides twice as much, so that they will not have to go out and gather manna on the Sabbath. In this daily provision, we discern many lessons. Lessons about developing daily trust in God. Lessons about learning to be content with provision that meets our needs. Lessons about meeting the needs of the whole community, not only our own. And a pattern of living that allows for a day without work, where we are redirected to worship God. This redirection toward God as the actor and provider in our lives is made throughout the text. We might read the story again with an eye toward this redirection. The text opens as the Israelites complain against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. They seem to have forgotten God's role in their own history and in their current lives, and instead direct their complaints to Moses and Aaron. However, it is God, not Moses, who heard their cries and delivered them from slavery. It is God who hears their cries now and provides them with food to eat. Moses and Aaron redirect the Israelites to God. In the evening, you shall know that it was the Lord who brought you out of the land of Egypt. And in the morning, you shall see the glory of the Lord, because he has heard your complaining against the Lord. Furthering the point, Moses and Aaron say, "For who are we that you complain against us?" This point is made over and over again. Draw near to the Lord, for he has heard your complaining. And God says to them, "I have heard the complaining of the Israelites." And finally, when the Israelites discover the manna on the ground, they ask, "What is it?" Moses answers them, "It is the bread that the Lord has given you to eat." It doesn't matter what the substance of the food is. What is important for them to know is that it is the bread that God has provided. God is continually saving them and sustaining them with daily bread. So as the Israelites ask, "What is it?" I am reminded of Barbara Brown Taylor's provocative question, "What is it that is saving or sustaining your life right now?" It is usually easy for us to identify what it is that is killing us or what it is that is causing us to struggle. Complaining comes easily for both the Israelites and for us. But what is it in this wilderness time that is sustaining us? What is it that is saving us as we walk this journey? I posed this question to some friends of mine, and here is what they said. One friend said, "Doing simple things such as having set dinner hours and making full dinners for the family is sustaining me." Another said, "Chocolate, definitely chocolate, and friendship." Another jokingly said, "Netflix." I affirmed that entertainment is actually a provision. Another said, "Having purpose to what I am doing daily, regular prayer, keeping in touch with special people." One friend noted Zooms with her family, Zoom worship services, and small group gatherings with her church. My mother said that the slower pace of life has allowed her to enjoy things like the box turtle that has made a home in their yard. One of my atheist friends said, "Teeth grinding grit. We're all just pushing through the impossible, sustained by hope." My own sense is that my life is sustained right now by the excitement of new ideas and new opportunities, by unexpected gifts, by cats and the silly things that they do, by cooking dinner with my daughter, by book groups and sermons, and by the company of all of you. Perhaps we can learn to see these blessings as our manna, the bread the Lord has given us to eat. We can find gratitude for these blessings and allow ourselves in our daily living to be redirected toward God. For it is God who hears our cries, sees our suffering, responds to our needs, and gives us hope for the future. What is the bread God is providing for you in this wilderness time? Amen.
Thank you.
Let us pray. God, like the Israelites in the wilderness, we too have known your love and experienced your care and provision. You call us to extend your love to the world around us, to care for others as deeply as we care for ourselves. And so we bring the needs of our world before you now. We pray for our nation. Heal our divisions and bring peace to our communities. Give us patience as we navigate the difficulties of COVID-19. Protect medical workers and others caring for the sick. Help us to care for and protect one another as we struggle with this pandemic. Especially in this time, we pray for all of your children who struggle to meet basic needs. Show us how to play a part in alleviating their suffering. Show us our role in promoting peace through our daily living. We pray for those who are sick, for those who are grieving losses of all kinds, and for those who are lonely or disheartened. God of the first and the last, and all those in between, your grace reaches out to all of us, lifelong believers or newcomers alike. You call us to live as citizens of heaven, to work together with one mind and one purpose, to reach out in love to those in need. Strengthen us that we might live in a manner worthy of the good news we have received, offering our lives to the building up of your upside-down kingdom, where the last are first and the first are last, and there is grace enough for all. And now let us continue to pray as Christ taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. What is it that is saving or sustaining your life right now? May we find manna at our feet and give thanks. And may the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now until we meet again. Amen.